Our speaker currently, he runs a forum for the New South Asia and works extensively on India-China-Pakistan cooperation. But apart from regional geopolitics, he is a political veteran, a commentator. He started out life as when he was at IIT Bombay as in student politics, and that, as we know, is quite literally where the country is at today. But from there, his trajectory took him into journalism as executive editor of Blitz in Bombay. It took him to a long stint at the BJP as an insider. He was a political strategist for Mr. L.K. Advani. He was a speechwriter for Mr. Vajpayee and held a host of key positions within the party. And now, as he works on, as we said, geopolitics and cooperation within the area, he has a vital view, both an insider and an outsider view, not just of the party, but of the country's politics per se, starting from student politics to the present moment. It is an absolute privilege to have Mr. Sudhindra Kulkarni here tonight and to have this conversation with him. It is a pleasure to invite back up on stage Mr. N. Ram. Thank you to both of you.
The theme today is interesting and one after my heart. How to defeat the BJP. And we have somebody with superb credentials. He's been with them. In particular, he's been with Prime Minister Vajpayee and the PMO and has worked closely with Mr. Advani. He's also takes positions on issues. Sudhindra Kulkarni, so it's a great pleasure to be able to discuss this particular subject. Now, first question, why should we defeat the BJP? After all, they won an election in 2014, they got about 31% of the popular vote at the Lok Sabha election. Now they increased it to 37%. To show cause why we should defeat the BJP.
Before I come to that, let me say a few mandatory words. I'm both delighted and in some way honored to be here in a conversation with you, someone that I have admired for a long, long time since my journalism days. Thank you, Algebra. Thank you, Nilanjan Tolia ji, Nina ji, and friends. I'm very happy to see a very dear friend and a colleague in this mission, Supriya Sule ji. And Supriya Sule, introduction to her partly answers this question. If there is one person, one political leader who transformed Indian politics in 2019, it is her father, Sharad Pawar. Something unthinkable happened in Maharashtra to show that the BJP can be defeated, can be kept out of power in a very important state like Maharashtra, and it was entirely the doing of Sharad Pawar, an 80-year-old warrior. And friends, he's going to play, I'm sure, an even more transformative role in 2020 and beyond. Let's wish him well. One more introductory point. Today is January 9, and January 9 is a historic day. It is on this day that in 1915, Mahatma Gandhi returned from South Africa. After 20 transformative years, he went as Mohandas Gandhi, he returned as Mahatma Gandhi. And Gandhi is forever relevant, but perhaps more relevant today than when he was alive. Especially from one particular perspective, that is Hindu-Muslim unity. The person who took him to South Africa was Haji Abdullah, a trader. It was in South Africa, and I've been to that place, in a mosque in South Africa, in Durban, that he first got the idea of Satyagraha. And he has written in his book, you know, there's a book that he has written, Satyagraha in South Africa, where he has mentioned the influence of Islam on his decision to begin to frame the concept of Satyagraha and also to begin the experiment of Satyagraha. And he, throughout his life, considered Hindu-Muslim unity to be more important than even Swaraj for India. And there is absolutely no leader in Indian history who has done as much for communal harmony, inter-religious harmony, not only in India, in world history, than Mahatma Gandhi. Today is, as I said, January 9. In 2021 days, we will reach January 30. Hey Ram, I was very happy listening to Kamal Hassan earlier. Friends, why BJP should be defeated? Let me begin with one answer. The assassin of Mahatma Gandhi has become a hero for many people in the ruling establishment today. Ask yourselves, in 72 years after independence, was there a time when Godse was made into a hero, as he's being done now? One person who's become a member of parliament, she praised Godse, and none other than the Prime Minister himself said that I cannot forgive her. Very strong words. Has the Prime Minister done anything? Godse's mentor, a person who in all probability is going to become a Bharat Ratna.
Savarkar.
Savarkar has become a big hero. And what Savarkar did in his later years, what he said, what he wrote, friends, our country is going in a wrong direction. I have worked for 16 years in the BJP. I worked very closely with two great leaders, Vajpayee ji and Advani ji. There can be differences. I'm sure that you have differences, and even now, I have some differences with the BJP of even those days, but they were trying to mainstream the BJP. They were actually trying to make the BJP a secular party.
Try to civilize the BJP?
No. No, I won't say that. Huh? I won't say that.
No, okay.
But they were trying to bring the BJP on secular lines. Now, I have a question. Prime Minister Modi, 5.5 years in power, has he once uttered the word secularism and shown his commitment to secularism? He hates the word secularism. He made a big show when he came back to power. He made a big show of, in the Central Hall of Parliament, going and bowing before a big replica of the Constitution. Secularism is a preambular principle. But secularism has been made into a bad word today by the BJP. This is why India is going in a wrong direction. And further on, I'm going to say quite a few things. Yes. Why it is going in the wrong direction, and why, therefore, the BJP should be defeated, and can be defeated, and will be defeated.
Kamal Hassan made an interesting point that today you couldn't make Hey Ram, which links with what you said. Now, let's go back to the beginnings, the origin of Hindutva. We discussed it a little earlier, Savarkar versus Golwalkar, and before that, Hedgewar. Savarkar coined the phrase Hindutva. Golwalkar, the second supremo, Satchang Salchalak, was really the man who shaped the RSS, and in a sense, all its affiliates. He was the real builder, 33 years, I believe, in that position. What is different from the vision of Golwalkar? I've been reading a book by, very interesting book by Jyotirmay Sharma, Golwalkar, the RSS in India. brought out several years ago and with a new introduction. He makes the point that the Mohan Bhagavat Modi combination has taken it far away from the approach of Golwalkar. And you were telling me earlier when we chatted that they have, to quote you, the present lot have internalized extremism. How does that fit in with this history? The Savarkar, Golwalkar, and this internalization of extremism.
You know, you may not agree completely with me, and perhaps many others may not agree completely with me, but having worked very closely with the BJP and even interacted with the RSS closely with at various levels, we need to accept the RSS as a legitimate stakeholder in India. There are wrong things about the RSS, there are also some good things about the RSS. If we only focus on the wrong things, then we are not doing the right thing. Now, this is not the platform to really go into the entire history of the RSS, but we need to be objective in assessing Golwalkar in an objective way, what was right about him and what was wrong about him. Golwalkar, friends, many of you may not know, was completely averse to RSS playing any political role. He wanted RSS to be away from politics and away from party politics. He was not in favor of the formation of the Jan Sangh. There was pressure on him by the Swayam Sevaks after Gandhiji's assassination and the ban on RSS, when RSS was having a very difficult time, that we need a political voice and a platform. And something else happened. Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee came out of Nehruji's cabinet on a Hindu issue, and therefore he gave his consent for the formation of the Jan Sangh, but on one condition, that the RSS will stay away from politics, we will have some pracharaks to work for the Jan Sangh. And he himself was completely apolitical. There are many things that you know, his critics either do not know or do not pay much attention to. For example, he was opposed to uniform civil code. He also praised Nehru on several occasions. The point I'm making is that Golwalkar, that was a different era. What we are seeing today is the era of Savarkarite BJP. It's not Golwalkar's BJP, much less the BJP of Deen Dayal Upadhyay. Deen Dayal Upadhyay, in my opinion, Pandit Deen Dayal Upadhyay, the ideologue, the philosopher, the guru of the BJP and earlier the Jan Sangh, is a very original thinker. Many wrong things about him, but also very many good things about him. Integral humanism, you know, his philosophical book is something worth reading, and I urge people on the left, people in the advocates and champions of secularism to read Deen Dayal Upadhyay, because Deen Dayal Upadhyay was not a proponent of the kind of Hindutva that is being practiced today. Now, I'm saying all this because if we want to save India from extremist Hindutva, then we have to see what resources we can get even from the history of the RSS and the history of the BJP, which can be of help to us. Yeah. For example, Vajpayee ji, you know, he said that if India cannot be secular, then India will not remain India. That was his commitment to secularism. And that's why I worked with him, and I still have immense regard for Vajpayee ji, and also for Advani ji. Advani ji, you know, significantly changed, you know, in his political life. So life, politics is not a stagnant lake. It keeps changing. And today, in the fight against communalism, in the fight against bigotry, in the fight against divisive politics of the worst kind that we have seen in 72 years, I see that we also have to make a section of the BJP's legacy, the RSS legacy, our ally in our struggle.
What explains the rise of the BJP from about 2013, very visibly in the electoral arena? Nobody was surprised at the outcome of 2014, although 2019, it was a bit of a surprise, the kind of overwhelming majority that they won after setbacks, and the impression they may not even get a majority. But what really, in your view, you get, yeah.
I see the BJP of Narendra Modi and Amit Shah completely different from the BJP of Atal Bihari Vajpayee. When Atal Bihari Vajpayee came to power in 1998, he did not have a majority on his own, so therefore he had to create this platform called the National Democratic Alliance, NDA, which itself put pressure on the BJP to become mainstream and become secular. But he also, because of his own conviction, felt that the BJP has to change. He had significant differences with the RSS. Even though he came from the RSS background, he had significant differences with from the RSS. People will not believe that amongst all the prime ministers that we've had, he's the one who went out of his way to normalize relations with Pakistan, which is absolutely necessary for communal harmony in India. He made the most sincere efforts. Of course, he did not succeed. He also made very sincere efforts to solve the Kashmir issue. Advaniji supported him in this endeavor. That's why I said that it was a different era for the BJP. What we are seeing today is a very cynical, sinister attempt to just consolidate the Hindu vote bank. For years and years, the BJP was accusing the Congress and other parties of playing vote bank politics. If there is any practitioner of vote bank politics today, it is the BJP, which has constructed a Hindu vote bank and wants to consolidate it by whatever means, fair or foul. And the Citizenship Amendment Act, NRC, all these things make it absolutely clear that their short-term intention is to somehow keep this vote bank, which will bring them back to power again in 2024. This is a short-term goal, but there's a long-term goal. And that long-term goal is to use this Hindu vote bank and political power to turn India into Hindu Rashtra. If India becomes Hindu Rashtra, India will not remain India, and which is why we must defeat the BJP.
Would you consider it a sort of fascist or semi-fascist project? Or is that too strong?
It is not just strong, not just too strong. It is also in some ways inappropriate.
Yes.
Because we sometimes use the word fascism loosely.
Yes.
The kind of fascism that we saw in Italy, in Germany, is not what we are seeing today. Although there are certain fascist elements in the conduct of the government now.
We can say fascistic.
Yeah, you may say that.
Yeah.
Because we have to be objective. Yes. We should not exaggerate to the extent that it falsifies the reality.
Yes.
What is certainly happening is that not only is the BJP trying to consolidate this Hindu vote bank, but it is constructing a new narrative of what I can say fake nationalism or a pseudo-nationalism, that only we are nationalists and our opponents are not just anti-government, anti-BJP, but they're anti-national. In 72 years of India's independence, we have never heard this argument, even polemically, which calls a large section of Indian society as anti-national. And this government, this political party, ruling party, has made one of the most obnoxious slogans a normal slogan. Desh ke gaddaron ko goli maro saalon ko. I mean, what kind of slogan is this?
You need to translate that in Tamil Nadu. And for me
the
also.
Traitors of India. Shoot them, kill them. Yeah. Now this is, you know, I tell you friends, you please go back and watch the video. When the Prime Minister went to Ramlila Maidan last month to give a long speech on CAA and NRC, and of course in that speech he spoke some lies, total lies, saying that since 2014 there has never been a discussion on NRC. He said that. He said there are no detention centers at all. Another big lie. But when people were coming for that rally, supporters of the BJP, you know, they were in the Prime Minister's rally, they were shouting such offensive, extremist slogans against Muslims, taking the name of Muslims, that your place is either Kabristan or Pakistan. Now, do we want this kind of India? These are not mere slogans, friends. If we allow this to continue, India is headed for disaster.
We now come to the Citizenship Amendment Act in linkage, in nexus with the National Register of Citizens and further the Population Register, National Population Register. How does this fit into this neo-BJP RSS project? Why did they do it now? Because you told me earlier that this protest against it, this upsurge, is bigger than the JP movement.
Yeah, you know, let me...
And then related to that, what are the drivers behind this massive upsurge, which is not only with respect to the spread and the scale of it, but also the duration of it, the fact that it is
you know, in these
sustained.
Dark times, yeah. In these really dark times, something very good is happening. And that is the way in the last two months, people have come onto the streets to protest. First, since 1947, we have not seen student mobilization and student protests on a scale and intensity that we are seeing today. It's bigger than the student movement in the JP movement. The student agitations that were inspired by and even led by Jai Prakash Narayan in the 70s were mainly confined to Bihar and Gujarat. Now it is all over the country, all over the country. So this student activism and youth activism is a real sign that the people of India, the young people of India, care for India and care for our constitution, our constitutional values. Unprecedented. The other thing that is unprecedented, which again augurs very well for India, is that for the first time since 1947, the Muslim community in India has taken to the streets on a scale we have not seen before. And they are doing so in order to assert their Indianness.
Yes.
Unprecedented. In every state, every city, even small towns, Muslims have become active. And as I said, they are reclaiming their Indianness, reasserting their Indianness.
And in this respect, the contrast to their response to the Kashmir outrage, what has been done on Kashmir, muted response, outside Kashmir, I mean.
Yeah. You know, this is second thing that's unprecedented. The third that is unprecedented is that the kind of Hindu-Muslim joint campaign that we are seeing, protest against CAA and NRC, and subsequently protest against this naked, violent aggression at Jamia and JNU and Aligarh Muslim University. It's not just the Muslims who are protesting. It is Muslims and Hindus protesting together.
Which would have gladdened Gandhiji's heart.
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, I was telling you in the morning that if we look back, friends, and take a longer view of history, this is the fourth episode in our history where we are seeing Hindu-Muslim unity of a kind that is that's truly heartening. The first was 1857, the first war of independence, which Hindus and Muslims fought together and made enormous sacrifices against the British rule. The second, under Mahatma, and the second was Tilak Jinnah Pact of 1916. Incredible happened that the Congress and the Muslim League held sessions together in Lucknow.
Yes.
Lokmanya Tilak goes to the session of the Muslim League, and Jinnah, of course, was a Congress leader too. And if the spirit of the Jinnah Tilak Pact of 1916 had held, had it sustained, India's history would have been different. Yeah. The third episode was the civil disobedience movement.
The Khilafat.
Support to Khilafat by Mahatma Gandhi. The kind of Hindu-Muslim unity that was generated then, unprecedented. Of course, things changed subsequently. And I see that today, 2020, we are once again witnessing a very intense joint struggle by secular Hindus and Muslims for saving our constitutional values. So, why is it happening? Because a lot of people are beginning to feel very apprehensive that, you know, India is changing in some very deep way and potentially disastrous way. Otherwise, you know, they may not know all the technicalities of CAA and NRC, but as far as Muslims are concerned, they see that they are being not just treated as second-class citizens, but now constitutionally reduced to that. I mean, this audience certainly knows, you know, your own paper has published excellent articles on CAA.
Yes.
But Article 14 of the Constitution, Article 15 of the Constitution, equality before law, no discrimination on the grounds of religion, are being blatantly violated by the Citizenship Amendment Act.
Equality before the law for not just citizens, but all persons.
Persons.
Within
friends,
the territory of India.
This is a very important distinction that we should understand. The framers of our constitution, they did not say just citizens, persons living in India.
So far as Article 14 is concerned, as distinct from 19 and so on,
yes,
is applicable fundamental rights only for citizens.
So, when we say, and Amit Shah is on record, he has given so many interviews saying that Hindus coming from this country, that country, they don't even have to give documents. We will give them citizenship automatically, but Muslims excluded, which means that Muslims belong less to India than others. We are saying it constitutionally. And going forward, NRC, those who do not have documents, their citizenship is under, you know, is in question, and then detention centers are already coming up. So a question that was so far confined to Assam, he had the audacity and the arrogance to say that NRC, not only for Assam, we will do it all over the country. Friends, just look at, you know, detention center is, you know, the very concept of a detention center where thousands of people are going to stay indefinitely. It's a shame on our civilization. I have one more question, you know, and that is especially a question for the RSS. You know, RSS talks about Akhand Bharat.
Yes.
That they were against the division of India, partition of India. They wanted India to be Akhand Bharat, united. Now, this CAA Is it in conformity with the concept of Akhand Bharat? On the one hand, we wanted all of the British era India to remain united. And now we are saying that that's okay, but only for Hindus. I mean, the sheer absurdity of saying that Akhand Bharat is for Hindus, for Hindutva, for Hindu Rashtra. Akhand Bharat is a Hindu Rashtra. Just think of the absurdity of this. But that absurdity is now being legislated. So, as I was saying, that we people should, the educated people, should say where our country is going.
Yes.
And we must, therefore, stop this process right now. And to do so, the BJP must be defeated. They must be disempowered. I'm not saying that just taking the BJP out of power will solve all of India's problems. No. And hopefully we'll have some discussion on the kind of alternative that we should build, which should be truly positive, far superior, etc. But right now, this massive resurgence that has taken place needs to be consolidated. And this positive energy and hundreds, maybe even thousands of new young leaders that have come up, that leadership, that self-motivation should be preserved and given a new positive, non-violent direction.
Let me shortlist a few questions or topics, given the need to manage the time. I'll just lay them and you can choose your priorities on this. One is the assault on democratic rights, including free speech. And related to that, the climate of fear and intimidation that's been created, how it affects media, and whether there's any change in the recent period is one set, broadly. The other is your great interest on building cooperation between India, China, and Pakistan, or India, Pakistan, and China, on which you have written and you have lectured. And three is this your book, this idea of the internet satyagrahis. And this book is titled Music of the Spinning Wheel, Mahatma Gandhi's Manifesto for the intriguing title, Mahatma Gandhi's Manifesto for the Internet Age. Those are areas. And fourthly, what you already said, what are the some thinking about alternatives? So,
friends, first about the media. I was listening to a person in the audience earlier. During the emergency, the assault on the media was open. Censorship was part of the constitutional, the new constitutional arrangement that was brought in the mid-70s. But now it's undeclared emergency. Never have we seen in non-emergency times such tight control on the media as we have seen in the last 5.5 years. Barring a few honorable exceptions, as Advaniji said soon after the emergency was lifted, you were asked to
bend,
but you chose to crawl. That is what sections of the media did. But now, even without the emergency, large sections of media are crawling. Why? Fear. Friends, this government, in a democracy, it is using fear, threats.
Just see what's happened to NDTV, the way they are terrorizing.
Yeah. It's a very good example. A very senior minister telling advertisers not to advertise on this channel so that the channel is starved of finance and subsequently collapses. Friends, where are we going? You may be for this party or that party, but certain constitutional freedoms and rights must be preserved Because otherwise, democracy cannot survive. Now, look at even the social media. I mean, the worst kinds of fakery on the social media is coming from the ruling party. False, you know, as you were saying,
disinformation.
Not just misinformation.
Disinformation is motivated and deliberate. Misinformation is what we do all the time. Sometimes, meaning you could be mistakes, you correct them, and so on. Media do that everywhere in the world, but you try to minimize that.
But deliberate.
And disinformation is scaled up on the social media and weaponized.
And we have the Home Minister on record. It's, you know, you can watch it. He says he's telling his own party people, it doesn't matter whether what you are saying is true or false. Go ahead, make it viral.
Yes.
He's saying it. So, the freedom of the media, freedom of the press, which is oxygen for democracy to survive, is being sucked away.
And some change recently, very recently, which you mentioned, noted, some change in the
true
performance.
You see, democracy hits back. People's mandate, it creates its own antidote. For example, with the change in Maharashtra, Jharkhand going out of the hands of the ruling party, suddenly some sections of the media are beginning to assert themselves. And you can see how the very same newspapers and magazines which never criticize the government are beginning to show some signs of criticism. Because they see that when thousands and thousands, you know, are protesting and the atmosphere in the country is changing, they see winds of change.
May it last.
It's a good thing.
And go forward.
Because it's not just the media. You know, imagine
Deepika Padukone.
Bollywood.
Deepika Padukone going to jail.
Bollywood. Hats off to these artists. They are speaking out. Intellectuals are speaking out. So it really doesn't matter whether you're a supporter of this party or that party, but we must support the right principles.
Okay, next, your favorite current project.
You know, when I friends to say something about what I'm doing now, my humble efforts to promote India-Pakistan understanding, India-Pakistan trust and cooperation, and also India-China. This is something which I was inspired by Vajpayee ji. I was fortunate to travel with him in 1999 on the same bus that took him from Amritsar to Lahore, the Lahore bus yatra. And
I read that you had a hand in that famous episode where Advani ji paid tribute to Jinnah's secularism.
You know,
yeah.
So that was one. And before I come to that Advani ji's trip, I want to, you see, why this BJP is different from the BJP that I worked in. When Vajpayee ji went to Pakistan, Lahore, it was a historic and a very bold move. There was a civic reception for him in Lahore, at the governor's house in Lahore. And he spoke in Urdu. You know, he was not just a great speaker in Hindi, but he was also a great speaker in Urdu. At the end of his speech, he read out his poem, Jang Na Hone Denge. Hindi mein hai, just four lines from that poem. Jang Na Hone Denge is that we shall not let another war to take place. Bharat Pakistan Padosi, Saath Saath Rehna Hai. Bharat Pakistan Padosi, Saath Saath Rehna Hai. Pyar Kare Ya War Kare, Donon Ko Hi Sehna Hai. Jo Hum Par Guzri, Bachon Ke Sang Na Hone Denge, Jang Na Hone Denge. It means that India and Pakistan, we are neighbors. Whether it is good times, bad times, we both have to share and suffer. What happened to our children, we shall not, what happened to us, we shall not allow that to happen to our children and future generations. We will not let another war to take place. Now, I was sitting in the Pakistani audience, and I could see several Pakistanis having tears in their eyes. Now, this is the voice of a true statesman, someone who appeals to the hearts and minds of even the so-called enemies and tries to bring about change. 2005, I was working very closely with Advaniji. I accompanied him on his visit to Pakistan. And why did he go to Pakistan? One reason was Musharraf, President Musharraf had invited him to lay the foundation stone of a Hindu temple from the Mahabharat era, Katas Raj. It's a historic temple in ruins, and the Pakistan government decided to renovate it and invited who? Advaniji, to lay the foundation stone. And Advaniji, as I said, you know, his political career has gone through many changes, but his own contribution to India-Pakistan normalization is very significant. He said that we should stop considering Pakistan as enemy, and Pakistanis should stop regarding India as enemy. Now, this is what inspired me, and therefore, even though I have left the BJP, I have tried to continue to, you know, participate in this mission. I keep going to Pakistan very frequently. Last month I was there. I have met Imran Khan, and I can tell you, friends, that there is far more anti-Pakistan sentiment in India than anti-India sentiment in Pakistan. There is not a single political party today, whether it's Imran Khan or Benazir Bhutto's son or Nawaz Sharif, which is taking an anti-India agenda. Even the military, and I want to say it because it needs to be said, that even the military establishment, General Bajwa, I know this from very, very close quarters, he wants peace with India. It's a very good opportunity if Modi decides he can create history. We can put this whole bitter, bloody episode behind us.
Despite Kashmir?
Even Kashmir issue can be resolved. Yeah. And Kashmir issue can be resolved only through an understanding between India and Pakistan. Otherwise, there is no solution.
And China?
China is our neighbor. China is a great nation, great civilization. We may have had a border dispute, but this border dispute has to be resolved. And I'm happy that at the Mahabalipuram summit, our two leaders have taken a decision to accelerate the process of resolving the boundary issue. India and China, two great Asian civilizations, if we work together, we can change the destiny of Asia, we can change the destiny of the world. The world is changing. The West is in decline. The West has completely lost its moral authority. Just look at what Trump is saying and what Trump is doing.
Yes.
Therefore, it is my conviction that India, China, and Pakistan, we should work together. There are not many people who agree with this, but India, China, Pakistan working together to show genuine concern for each other's core interests and find a common ground and resolve issues, including the issue of Kashmir, the issue of the border between India and China, we can change the destiny of South Asia. South Asia is our common civilizational community and family. The most populous region in the world, 1.7 billion people. We share so many common bonds of religion, of language, of culture. But also, South Asia is today home to the largest number of poor people.
Yes.
Isn't it our responsibility to change the picture of South Asia? And for this, isn't it our responsibility to bring about reconciliation and normalization between India and Pakistan, India-Bangladesh, India-Nepal, India, Sri Lanka, we need to have a new vision and not, you know, pull our country down into something completely divisive and destructive. CAA, is this our priority? Is NRC India's priority? So it is time educated Indians began to question and start talking about new ideas. We need new thinking. And those, you know, to come to the last point, some of those ever new thinking, friends, is in Mahatma Gandhi. You know, when I researched on, people generally think that Mahatma Gandhi was against science, against technology, against modernity, because what was, you know, he was seen spinning the wheel, the charkha. He advocated village industries. So people think that he's anti-modernity. But when I researched, I found that he was most modern. He had full faith in the revolutionary power of science and technology. And that is what I've tried to capture in my book. And I believe that the basic philosophy of the spinning wheel, there is something common between the philosophy of the spinning wheel and the potential of the internet age. We can recreate the future of mankind on the lines of truth, non-violence, universal love, universal brotherhood, which the spinning wheel represented.
Yes, did I hear that bell? Did I? Yes, I did. So I'll cheat a bit and ask the last question I wanted to raise as an audience question. Yeah. And then they, on alternatives, I'm sure somebody would have asked anyway. And then we'll have genuine questions from others. Alternatives.
You know, it is the best thing to have happened. You know, these agitations and the protests, tens of thousands of people, especially young people coming onto the streets and questioning the government, the best thing to happen is that it is happening barely 6 months into the tenure of the new government. If the government does not change its ways, its policies, it is going to more and more problems. And I genuinely hope that the Prime Minister does not stand on ego and tells Parliament that we are not doing anything on NRC and we are going to in fact change, bring about positive changes even in CAA. If he does that, he will do a lot of good to himself and of course to the country. But I don't have much hope of that happening. The kind of arrogance that we have seen, and that arrogance is in fact multiplied after May 2019 with a renewed mandate, I don't see that happening. And it is therefore our responsibility to think of the alternative. And the alternative should not be just change of the government. The alternative has to be a superior alternative in terms of governance, in terms of development, in terms of our idea of India, in terms of secularism, you know. And here we have a big responsibility to engage that large section of the Hindu community which is supporting Modi, which is supporting the BJP, today's BJP. We should engage them in a dialogue, and we should convince them that this is not true Hinduism. What can weaken India, what can polarize India, cannot be Hinduism. So we have a big responsibility. If we don't do this, there is a real possibility, friends, of actually the BJP gaining from this. Because the BJP wants this whole agitation to be projected as anti-Hindu. Aur Pradhan Mantri no keh diya. The Prime Minister, the most shocking thing to have come out of the mouth of a prime minister, when he said at a rally in Jharkhand, oh, we can identify these people just looking at their clothes.
So
he's telling his own constituency.
So whether you agree with everything said so far or not, I'm sure you'll join me in commending my conversationalist for being very clear, absolutely clear in his diagnosis as well as the prescription. That's where I hand it over
yes,
to you.
Yes, just, it is late on a weeknight. We'll take a couple of questions and then those of you who'd still like to engage with Mr. Kulkarni, hopefully please do stay back for a drink. If there are any questions, do let us know. Yeah, there are. We'll take the mic around.
Sir, my name is Aruna. Can you see me, sir? I'm here.
Where?
Yeah, okay. Do you want me to come there?
Yeah, why don't you come forward, if you don't mind.
Yeah. So you spoke about every section of the society stepping out, students, artists, and even media is changing its tune. And so what puzzles me is corporate India, which has empowered this government by the kind of phenomenal funding through the electoral bonds, why are they silent, barring for a few? Even if you take a country like America, they're speaking out, Silicon Valley speaks out. Why is corporate India still silent? They wield an enormous amount of power over government because they're funding the government, funding the party, not the government. So given that, why do you think corporate India is still...
So the answer is simple. If the media and the owners of the media can be threatened, look at the stakes that the corporate India has. So we can understand why they are silent. And very frankly, you know, for the kind of alternative that we want to build, that alternative will come from the streets, from the common people.
Expect the unexpected.
The corporates, you know, privately, they know exactly what is happening. So let us not expect the corporate India to come out, because we know why they are not speaking out. And they're not really, you know, going to add enormous strength to this protest, this agitation at this point in time. The answer is obvious. Let us therefore concentrate on the people, all sections of the people, especially intellectuals, artists, professionals, and then take it to the common masses. And I want to especially say this, that there is a danger, friends. The BJP will try to make this whole protest as something anti-Hindu, and therefore consolidate its own vote bank further. So we have to engage the Hindu community, that section of the Hindu community, for various reasons, which has supported the BJP, which still believes in Modi. We should engage them. And for this, I would urge that those sections of the left that have an aversion to engaging this kind of the Hindu community, they should also change their ways. We have to truly make this a national effort and keep our differences to the margins. Because it really requires a lot of change in the way we have functioned so far, the way we have dealt with each other. A national alliance, a national front, a national movement will require us to work very closely in a new way. And this is my appeal to the people on the left, the people from the Muslim community. It is extremely important that we tell the leaders of the Muslim community that in this joint effort, don't try to make it, again, bring in extremism of the Muslim kind in this agitation. Otherwise, it will defeat the purpose.
There was a question somewhere in the middle. Yeah.
Oh, sorry. Shall I come to the front, sir?
Yes, okay. Why not? Thank you.
Sir, I have two questions for you. Number one, what do you think of the future program of BJP? One is the uniform civil code and anti-conversion laws. And the second question is, sir, distinguished members like you, Mr. Yashwant Sinha, who was here some time back. While you were in BJP, why did you not make an attempt to make the party moderate? What is the point of leaving the BJP and then criticizing it?
Okay, okay. We got it. Thank you. Yes, we got it. He's going to respond to that. Yeah, thank you.
You see, there are certain issues. If the BJP actually engages other sections of our democratic establishment and say that these are issues of concern to the nation, let's talk with each other and find a way of dealing with them, including the Citizenship Act. I am completely convinced that if Modi ji, before coming to parliament, had he engaged the political parties in some kind of an all-party meeting, significantly, Modi has had very, very few all-party meetings, whereas all-party meetings were a common feature during Vajpayee ji's time, because Modi ji does not believe in a dialogue with the opposition. So had he consulted the opposition, even the Citizenship Act itself could have been done in a very different way. And the same thing goes to some of the other issues that you mentioned. Now, as far as, you know, I cannot speak for others. As far as I'm concerned, I joined the BJP because at that point in time, I believed that here is a leadership that is trying to change its own message, its own beliefs. And I had an opportunity to work closely with the party at a certain high level. But after 2004, I saw that, this is a point that we should understand. When the BJP lost the election in 2004, the blame was put on Vajpayee ji, that he had abandoned Hindutva, and that's why we lost. And therefore, the party has to be now brought back to the Hindutva agenda. And what is the Hindutva agenda? The Hindutva agenda is not the development agenda.
It is to subvert the constitution.
It is to create a Hindu vote bank so that we can now move towards the Hindu Rashtra agenda. So, that friends, what we are seeing now started happening in the aftermath of 2004. And after Advaniji's visit to Pakistan, he was blamed. And I was blamed. And I felt that this is not the place where for me to work, because I cannot really make any significant contribution. I have come out of the BJP. I want to say this again so that I'm not misunderstood. There are many good things about the BJP. There are also many good things about the RSS. So we need to create a new conversation. We should not think in black and white terms. And I believe there are many sensible, moderate people in the BJP even now who cannot speak out openly, but I'm sure that they know that what is happening is not right.
Yeah, we've heard you.
One moment. Okay. We'll just get a mic to you, and then if you could ask the question you'd like, and then we'll close it after that.
I'm sorry to say that. Why cannot they speak out? If they're in the BJP, if they have questions, why can they not speak out?
Okay.
See, it's...
I don't think there is any... Sorry to say, sir, this is not an emergency situation here that we are having, okay? The BJP is doing very well. He has come with a second mandate. There's...
You know, people will start speaking out when the BJP begins to lose more and more and more states.
As they are doing now.
And when the BJP loses Uttar Pradesh in 2022...
No, let's not have back and forth. You made your point. He's responding, and let's leave it at
See,
that.
See, my point is...
We don't want heckling, constant interruptions, and etc.
No,
that's not the way here. Just to make the point.
When does rethinking and articulation of that rethinking happen in any political party? In two ways. When that party begins to actually lose people's support, as is happening now, then there will be internal murmurings and subsequently internal questioning. It is bound to happen in the BJP, as it is bound to happen in any political party. The second thing that will make them question is people's pressure. When tens of thousands of people begin to question and begin to say that what you're doing is wrong, then their own language will change. Now, why did Modi, Prime Minister Modi, in his Ram Lila Maidan speech, why did he have to say what he said? You know, untruths, because he could see that people are protesting. And I genuinely hope that if these protests continue, he knows that his own image is taking a beating. And whether he changes or not, I am sure that sensible people in the BJP will start questioning at some point or the other. But let's not rely on that. The change will not come from within the BJP. The change will come from all of us.
On that note, thank you, Mr. Kulkarni. Thank you, Mr. Ram. Thank you for joining us.